Hi, Phil Aston here from nowspinning.co.uk. In this video, I'm going to look at the Deep Purple album, Come Taste the Band. Now, this is one of my favourite, it's in the top three of my favourite Deep Purple albums. I'd probably put it Made in Japan first, Burn second, and this one third. And you can see from the t-shirt I'm wearing, I'm a bit of a fan of it. And I have been for decades. It didn't start that way. In fact, I didn't buy it when it was first released. I was such a massive Ritchie Blackmore fan, and I'd grown up with Deep Purple. I was still a teenager, but to me, Ritchie Blackmore was everything about Deep Purple. I'd seen Deep Purple on the Burn tour, and he dressed in black, and he had this kind of mysterious aura about him, and he's playing around 1974 to 76 is just absolutely phenomenal. So when I heard that Blackmore was leaving Purple, I just thought it was over for them, to be honest. And if you've seen my other video on Ritchie Blackmore's Rainbow, the first album, you'll know what I mean. So please watch that video if you get a chance. But Rainbow's first album was released in July 75, and Come Taste the Band came out in November, I think, of the same year. At the same time, Tommy Bolin's solo album came out as well. And I just wanted nothing to do with it. As far as I was concerned, the band was finished. I didn't go and see them, I didn't buy any tickets. They were my favourite band, but I didn't go. I remember coming home on the bus from work, I think it was heading towards Christmas 75, and in the paper I was reading, it mentioned, it had like a list of records to buy your teenage son or daughter. And under the rock section, it showed Come Taste the Band by Deep Purple, saying if you've got a son at home or seems to have long hair and t-shirts and long grey overcoats, then maybe this is the album for him. And I thought, maybe. And the reviews had been kind of mixed, and the feeling was that, you know, the band was they were on a path. I mean, let's think about Stormbringer. They were on a path of change. So I just thought, well, maybe they're going more in that direction, even though I like Stormbringer. Nevertheless, I when I saw the album in the record shops, it was a luxurious affair. And by that I mean the last two Purple albums had been single sleeves, with no lyric sheet. I know Stormbringer had the lyrics on the back, but they were fairly bog standard albums really. But Come Taste the Band had a luxurious feel about it. It was back to a gatefold sleeve, nice glossy cover, and all the pictures in the centre of the album in the gatefold were all pictures of a band at the height of their success. And you know, they all looked fantastic, they all looked really cool, and there were helicopters, there were large crowds, and the poses were great, and it was a well put together album cover. I must say, it looked very, very classy. The wine glass on the front and on the back with the lipstick, etc., it looked really good, and it came with the lyrics. So I went for it, I bought it, and my expectations were level, really. But I got home, put it on, turned up the amp, and boom. I think, before I start, I think one observation, and here's something for Ear Music if you're going to do yet another Deep Purple compilation, is call it Track 1, Side 1. Because every Deep Purple album, Track 1, Side 1 has been absolutely killer. And this was no different. Coming home, started like with a crash ending, you know, how they kind of started Burn at that, on all the live albums at that point, you know, snap on the drums and then just an explosion of sound, and that's how Coming Home starts. And then Tommy Bolin's Echoplex comes in and they're off, and that is a great opening track. There's some great lyrics from David Coverdale, BB on stage, Lucille, and all that kind of stuff. And it's a vehicle for Tommy Bolin. The guitar solo is immense to me. And those of you who are Tommy Bolin fans, you'll know what I mean when I say this, but he has these kind of little motifs where you know it's him, and he puts these motifs in a lot of his solos. And I think that's really cool, because I can't think of many other guitarists that do that. They have a specific triplet or little trick that they do, and they put it in all over the place, and they're in this track. Once you've heard them, you start to realise he does them quite a lot. It's a great track. In fact, Jane Houston doesn't play on it because he was a bit worse wear at that time than Bowling plays bass on it. But it's a great, great opening track. I absolutely love it. In fact, it's one of my favourite tracks off the album. But I say track one, side one, any Deep Purple album, spot on. The next one in is Lady Luck, which has got a kind of Bad Company feel to it. I do think Coverdale's performance on this album is just stunning. His voice had matured, it was rich, rugged, and kind of helped, I don't know how to describe this, it's like held back slightly, but the real richness in his voice is just superb. So quite a small track in length, Lady Luck, but wonderful dynamics, fantastic dynamics, I think. And then we come to me another high point of the album, which is Getting Tighter. This is a classic riff to me. It's a real funky but rock-based riff. And this is a vehicle for Glenn Hughes on this track. And there's so much going on this. It's got great, awesomely tight chorus. The other thing I want to mention on this album is Ian Paice. This period, and rolling on through to Paice, Ashton and Lord, I think Ian Paice was on fire. And I think he was inspired by the different timings. This was going outside of the 4-4 kind of stuff he'd known with Purple. And because of the kind of funk nature of some of the tracks and offbeats, he really, really was on top form. And I think the way Glenn Hughes and Ian Paice locked together on some of this music is just superb. And so it's an absolute great track. There are a couple of guitar solos based around really kind of funky, quite techie backings on this, but I think it's an absolutely stunning track. Next is, excuse me, Dealer. And even Bowling has a verse to sing on here, and he's got a wonderful, gentle voice. But it's again, another great song. Brilliant solo from Tommy Bowling. Then we roll on to I Need Love, which is probably the funkiest song I think they ever did. But Coverdale's voice carries it. It's an uplift. Those of you who are fans of this album, you know what I mean, but the interplay between Hughes and Coverdale is very different on this album than, say, Burn or Stormbringer. And I think Martin Birch's production takes it up a notch. I think there's more space in the soundstage, but I think Coverdale's voice is just immaculate. And the end runs of guitar from Bowling at the end are just magical. And on the remix, that came out a couple of years ago, the double CD, it's even better because the fades just keep going. Now we come to my second favourite track on the album, which is Drifter. This is a hard rock tour de force, really. It's superb, really, really well-timed lyrical delivery by Coverdale. There's some really kind of heavy, fast riffs in it, but there's also this part in the middle where it goes into a gentle kind of lull, where it just starts to build on that, on the bass and the drums. I just think it's absolutely magical. It's just such a wonderful track. And then it kind of accelerates towards the end, and it's just fantastic. That would have been killer live if they'd held it together and been as tight as they were on this studio version of that track. Absolutely brilliant. Next up is Love Child, probably the first song that has some real input from John Lord with the synthesizer solo. The riff is, I think, borrowed from a James Gang track. But it's a great track, and again, Coverdale's voice, I think, is just superb. You know, it's one of his top moments, I think, Come Taste the Band. Then we come to John Lord's primarily solo spot, which is This Time Around, an Ode to G. Now, Lord is very much in the background in this album, and I don't know whether it was to give space for Tommy Bowling to establish himself, which is what I think was probably going on. You know, but Bowling basically was writing basically 99% of the music, really. But this track, this time around with Glenn Hughes on vocals, is again a masterpiece of songwriting and recording, I feel. It's just beautiful. And then it goes into a ode to Gershwin perhaps, a very jazz orientated instrumental with Tommy Bolin, and again lots of stop start funky bits with the whole band really gelling together. And then for many people, the kind of emotional end of the album is You Keep On Moving. This was a single which obviously did nothing because it was so far removed from Deep Purple as people saw them. But as time has gone by, I think it's become seen as the Mark IV track. If there are any compilations that have Mark IV tracks on, it's nearly always this one that gets picked. It's almost a ballad. Apparently it was written during the Mark III period, but Blackmore didn't like it, so it was shelved. But it builds and builds, and it's got some fantastic, again, lyrics and phrasing and stuff, Arms Around the Sun. I just love it. But the bit that really, really makes it for me is the outro, the ending, as Tommy Bolin comes in for that guitar solo. It's a double track guitar solo, which he did a lot of. And he's kind of doing a question and answer thing with himself. And the notes are just beautiful. And the final kind of flurry of the notes coming down like a waterfall down the side of a mountain, it's just brilliant. And it ends with like Glenn Hughes running his finger down the neck of his bass guitar. Absolutely brilliant. So some people might say, well, it's not really a Deep Purple album. It is a Deep Purple album. It's good to see a band progressing. I mean, who wants to see a band that just does the same thing over and over again? Every Deep Purple album was different. It was progression to where they were going next, through every single version of Purple, to where they are today. I mean, I'm a huge fan of the Morse lineup as well. But Come Taste the Band sounds great now. It was ahead of its time, and the production is brilliant. So that's my view on it. So I thought I'd also share and give us a chance to have a look at the different versions that are available and my recommendations of perhaps what you should get if you haven't got it already. So let's first of all look at the vinyl versions. As I said, it was a glossy and luxurious looking album, I felt. This was a great design, you know, play on words perhaps, but I think it really stood out. And inside the gatefold, I say, wonderful 1970s gloss on the cover. But all these pictures to me, for my kind of 16-year-old self, showed a band at the height of its powers. Interestingly, Tommy Bolin is the only person not shown playing an instrument, but you could tell that he was a bit of a poser. So he kind of lent, I think, that influence, obviously, was also shared by Glenn Hughes and Coverdale, who are on this gatefold sleeve, are also kind of throwing some shapes and making sure they look good for the photos and they've got good hair. That's the original, that's my original from 1975. It also came with a lyric sheet with some nice wine design around as well. And that kind of saw me through the rest of the 70s and the 80s. Then in 1978, this appeared, which I picked up at a record fair in Birmingham, and I thought, oh, a rare Deep Purple album, I've never seen that before, pressed in Czechoslovakia on the other side of the Berlin Wall. And it was actually Come Taste the Band. But because at that time in the Eastern Bloc, you know, kind of people with long hair were kind of definitely frowned upon, there was actually no pictures at all with the band. The only thing that was included in there was a poster, all in Czechoslovakian, so please don't ask me to read it out. And inside was a giant poster of a piece of fruit. which again, I guess, was because they weren't allowed to show the band. They weren't allowed to show the band with long hair. So that's quite a worthwhile kind of collector's item if you can find it, which I think you can find on eBay for not the kind of prices you might think it might go for, but it's a great piece. The other one I want to share with you is the remaster and the remix, which came out a few years ago. And this is probably the only other vinyl version, apart from the Warner Brothers one, if you really want to be completist, you should go for. The photography on the inside of this is a little bit, not as sharp as the original, so it looks a bit like it's a bit of a facsimile. The other thing I'd like to point out, actually, whereas it said it was filmed at the World at Large on the inside here, that was actually a film crew and a programme, so that there was a documentary made about Deep Purple at this time. Unfortunately, no one can find the tapes. So this is the remaster, which is from 2010, and it's a double album, and there's the side one and two is basically the original album, but it's being remastered, and sides three and four are remixes by Kevin Shirley, which you can tell from, you probably can't see from here, but we'll go through the CD in a moment, that the tracks are longer. And this came with two lovely inner sleeves with different photographs and all the text that you got from the CD and the story of the album, and a couple of press posters at the bottom as well. But I'm going to talk more in depth now when we go over the CD. And the first one is from 1990, so this is the original version that was released on CD, which came with the lyrics, a reprint of the gatefold sleeve, and the credits across the top of the vinyl gatefold sleeve with imprinted on the back. And it's not a bad sounding CD, however, those of you train spotters amongst us, on You Keep On Moving, there is a slight fault, a slight click towards the front end of the track, which I thought was a problem with the CD, but on a remastered version on the Listen, Learn and Read On box set, it was there as well. So there must have been a fault on the original recording, and I have, with the original vinyl, turned it up really loud, and it is there in the background, so there must have been an original recording fault on that. The next one I purchased was this, which is the Japanese mini LP CD. The gatefold's a bit pale, but it's a good sounding CD and comes with the lyrics as well. But the one I would recommend that everyone should have, if you're a fan, or you're going to be a fan, because I'm sure you will if you've never heard this before, is the 35th Anniversary Edition 2 CD set. Now this comes with a slipcase and two discs. One is the remix and one is the remaster. And this is very well put together, with lots of detail, lots to read, lots of archive photographs and posters, etc. A lot of photos that at the time I'd not seen before. Some of these replicated in the vinyl reissue. And there's a picture of the Czechoslovakian one. But all great stuff. But this is exceptional, not just because of the remastering, but because, in fact, of the two extra bonus tracks. I mean, if you're a fan of Tommy Bolin and Deep Purple and Come Taste the Band, the idea of there being any kind of bonus tracks is like the Holy Grail, really. And you've got two tracks here, same in LA, but the one that makes it all is the Bolin Pace Jam. It's just Ian Pace putting down some rhythms and Tommy Bolin jamming over the top. And Bolin is on fire. I have to say also that Kevin Shirley's remixes are outstanding. You know, they are absolutely, I mean, this album sounds new now. It's the production by Martin Birch was just immense and is so ahead of its time, but Kevin Shirley has just polished it, shone some lights on it, on the dark places within the mix, and it just sounds absolutely fantastic. Notary mentions for CD would go to the rehearsal CDs, which were released by Purple Records. I've started here with volume 2. which isn't as good as Volume 1, which I'll come on to, which just is basically 30 minutes of the Drifter, a jam, Sail Away riff, You Keep On Moving, Take One, which is really good, Pirate Blues jam, and Sail of Me, which of course ends up on Coverdale's first solo album. But these jams are quite long, but the one I would recommend is this one, which is the first one. Which is June 1975, so the album was going to come out just a few months later. But this has got a great booklet with it. Even came with a, if you ordered it, there was a special edition of the photographs in this available separately, which I have. So there's some really good stuff in this. But the key thing is the, if we show the tracks with it on the back, yes. Is you've got O to G, you've got If You Love Me, A Woman jam, 10 minutes, the Orange Juice song, they've got I've Got Nothing For You jam, 12 minutes, nearly 13 minutes there, Dance to the Rock and Roll, which of course they interspersed into getting tighter on the life stuff, and the Aston jams. But Tommy Bolin on this, he's at home with himself, that it's funky, it's jazz rock, it's jazz fusion. So he must have felt quite frustrated when he was kind of shoehorned into playing so much of the old Purple stuff. But I would recommend this as to complete your Come Taste the Band experience as well, really. Great stuff. So hope that was enjoyable. That was my overview of Come Taste the Band by Deep Purple. It would be so easy now to just roll into which is the best live Mark IV recording you can get, but I'm going to save that for another video. But Come Taste the Band, it's another flavour of Deep Purple. If you're a fan of Tommy Bolin, it's essential. And for kind of mid-70s rock with a kind of funky influence, it really is in my, as I say, it's in my top three Purple albums, and it would be in my top 10 albums if I had to run away today and jump on a desert island. Come Taste the Band would be one of those albums that I'd have tucked under my arm. Thanks very much, and I'll see you on the next one. Thank you.